honor God me to be here today.
Yeah.
And we're not going to be before you long, and we're going to read from the scripture for this morning. You don't really have to stand because we're going to be up in there. It'll be a couple of scriptures here and there, but our main focus this morning is John 3:16.
All right.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
Precious Father God, in the name of Jesus, as I come before your people, God, we ask you to decrease me that you may increase, that they may receive a word on today. And God, we thank you, God, for the blessings for this Christmas Eve. Amen.
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 Thank you, Lord. Bless you, God.
Christmas is a time when we hear different stories. We hear stories in many different versions. We hear stories about baby Jesus in the manger and what Mary had to go through. We hear all these different things, and we say Jesus is the reason for the season, which is a true point. Jesus is the reason for the season, but why was Jesus here? What is his real reason? What was the reason for him coming? Mm-hmm. And Jesus came to give us love, the precious gift of love, to redeem man back unto the Father. And on this morning, we're going to come from a couple of places, and I thought about how can I present this, and you might laugh a little bit, but I was watching How the Grinch Stole Christmas. And many times, you know, kids are calling the police and telling, oh, the Grinch is going to steal Christmas. But the actual moral of the story is love.
Yes.
About God's love, actually, because God is love. And as you think about the story of how the Grinch stole Christmas, it all begins with everyone in the town called Whoville. And they're running along doing, what do? Going to Macy's, we go on Lord of Taylor, we go on the Pathmark. We're preparing for the day, and they're all excited because it's Christmas, and it's supposed to be the most joyous, wonderful day. It's the day where people believe magical things happen and dreams come true. That's how they think of Christmas. And little Cindy Who, she asks her father, What is this all for? Is it worth it? I just can't understand it anymore. Us running around buying gifts and this, it has to be more than that. But the father says, no, this is what we do because we love Christmas. Christmas is the happiest time of the year. But Cindy begins to ponder, what is the real reason? Why do we do this? What is the purpose? And as time goes on, the Grinch begins to appear in the town because some kids went up to the mountaintop and bothered him. And he came down to town to see what was going on. And he realizes now Christmas time. But he starts some mayhem. And when Cindy encounters the Grinch, she begins to realize what Christmas is really about. And no one else. So she goes around and starts inquiring. And she finds out that the Grinch used to be a part of the society. But the people didn't accept him for who he was. They laughed at him, they ridiculed him, he was abused, he was bullied. Things that we feel, he lost trust in the community, the people all around him. So he went to the mountain. Eventually Cindy goes and she wants to nominate him to be a part of their winter festival because she said everyone should enjoy what Christmas brings, this joy, this love that Christmas brings. She goes to see him, and she brings him back, and the people are laughing because they're like, oh, no way, do you actually want to nominate this man to be the honoree? But as time goes on, to speed it up, that the Grinch comes back again, and because he's so angry at how they treated him at the festival, now he wants to steal Christmas because it reminded him that they never forgot about how they treated him. He remembered how they treated him before. Yeah. They still didn't accept him, but this little girl, Cindy, accepted him when no one else did. She saw that he needed love, and all he needed was love. So Cindy goes back after he steals Christmas, so-called steals Christmas, and she begins to talk to him. And that one little girl changed the Grinch. One little girl. Just by extending love. And so I'm going to give you 4 points how the gift of love is revealed in Christmas.
Yes.
Christmas reveals God. God is where Christmas begins. The miracle of Christ makes clear that there is a God who acts in the world. The fulfillment of the prophecy reveals a God who is sovereign. The virgin birth of Christ demonstrates God's love by sending his son. The second point.
Thank you, God.
Christmas reveals God's love for the world. The God revealed at Christmas is a God of love. Mm-hmm. Christmas teaches us that the God who exists is the God who loves. And that's 1 John 4:7-8. Beloved, let us unselfishly love and seek the best for one another. For love is from God, and everyone who loves others is born of God and knows God through personal experience. Verse 8, the one who does not love has not become acquainted with God, does not and never did know him, for God is love. He is the originator of love, and it is an enduring attribute of his nature. Now it's from the Amplified Bible if it doesn't read that way in yours. Only the one true God revealed in Jesus Christ engages us as the God who loves people. God's love for the world is profoundly encouraging. 2 Thessalonians 2:16-17 reads, Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who has loved us and given us everlasting comfort and encouragement in the good, well-founded hope of salvation by his grace. Verse 17, comfort and encourage and strengthen your hearts, keeping them steadfast and on course in every good work and word. Because God is characterized by his love for people, shouldn't we be as well?
Yes.
That's what Cindy did in the Grinch.
Yes.
Christmas, my third point, Christmas reveals God's love for the world and giving. The essence of love is making sacrifices for others. 1 John 15:13 states, but I'm going to start at John 12. This is my commandment, that you love unselfishly, seek the best for one another, just as I have loved you. No one has greater love, no stronger commitment than to lay down his life for his friend. Now that's something our friend died for us. And now we're talking about 1 John 3:16-17. By this we know, we have come to understand the depth and the essence of his precious love, that he willingly laid down his life for us because he loved us.
Thank you, God.
And ought to lay down our lives for the believers. Verse 17, but whoever has the world's goods and sees his brother in need but has no compassion for him, how does the love of God live in him? So how can we not love our neighbor? How can we express God's love? We accept the God in our lives, and we are the givers of love because God is love and we are a part of God. Anyone unwillingly to sacrifice for others cannot love, because sacrifice is a nature of true love. And I know I keep going back to the story of the Grinch, but if you think about it, little Cindy sacrificed herself. She sacrificed her time by going around inquiring, asking people, you all know this Grinch. What is it? Why did y'all do this to him? Because she wanted to know how to approach him. She wanted to meet his needs. So she was unselfish. She wanted him to have what she had. And she wasn't worried about material things, because she could have went to the store and bought him a gift, but she wanted him to feel what was in her heart, and that was love, her joy. My fourth point, Christmas reveals God's love for the world in giving his son. God's only begotten Son, on the contrary, is not a son by creation or adoption, but by begetting. John 1 verses 1 through 2, and I'm reading from the Common English Bible now. We announce to you what existed from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have seen and our hands handled about the word of life. The life was revealed, and we have seen, and we testify and announce to you the eternal life that was with the Father, and was revealed to us. In calling the Son of God, the only begotten Son, Jesus distinguishes himself as the uniquely eternal divine Son of God. Amen. God shows us his love by giving us his Son. Yeah, right. So had he not went to Mary, placed his seed into Mary, for Jesus to be born, to become flesh, to understand and walk among us, and to die on the cross, we wouldn't have this love. He cared that much for us, and he said it all the way back in Genesis, which John really refers to, where the other gospels talk about the virgin birth and what happened and the wise men and the different things that occurred. But John takes you all the way back to the beginning, and in Genesis, where he said he was going to send another, a redeemer, and this was the prophecy being fulfilled. God's love is revealed in the great word of his gift. 1 John 4, verses 9-10, and I'm reading from the Common English Bible again. This is how the love of God is revealed to us. God has sent his only Son into the world so that we can live through him. This is love. It is not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice that deals with our sin.
Yes.
That is love.
Thank you, God.
God's love is revealed in the unworthiness of its recipients.
Yes.
God's love gives its best for the benefits of others, even when they don't deserve it. And as I close more, I encourage you to love God as God has loved you.
Thank you.
And 1 John 4, verse 11 and 12, in the Common English Bible again. Dear friends, if God loved us this way, we also ought to love each other. No one has ever seen God. If we love each other, God remains in us, and his love is made perfect in us.
Yes, God.
The evidence of Christmas is the love of God in Christ.
Yes.
Because God operates out of love, we must love.
Yes.
Because God loves people, we must love. Because God loves sacrificially, so must we. Ephesians 5, verses 1 through 2. Therefore, become imitators of God. As well beloved children. Imitate their father and walk continually in love. That is, value one another, practice empathy and compassion, unselfishly seeking the best for others. Jesus, for others, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us in an offering and sacrifice to God, slain for you so that it became a sweet fragrance. To live a life that matters is to live a life of love. And we need to do this. First, we must receive God's gift of Christ to receive Christ in faith. Second, we need to receive God's gift of Christ to love others enough to give them Christ.
Yeah.
That's good.
And now I extend to you, is there anyone here who has not received the love of God?
Thank you, God.
Who want to offer the love of God to someone else?
Yes.
And everyone here has accepted God in their life, has accepted Christ in their life, and they know the love of God. I ask you to send that love this season, no matter what someone does to you,
yes,
how they
yes,
treat
God.
You, it's just God's love.
Yes,
God. And that's what we have to do. But if everyone has that and they feel that they have Christ in their life, we'll still just come to the altar.
Yes, God. Thank you, Lord.
Because this is a season that we want to be able to extend love more to people.
Amen.
And I think about one this week. I was just walking downtown New Brunswick, just talking to God, talking to my Father, holding my hand, loving on me. And I didn't realize I had such a smile on my face till the gentleman stopped me on the street and asked me, are you on a phone?